Let's turn our attention now to example number 8. In this example, we have a piecewise function that's given, and this is a messy piecewise function. We should understand loosely how to graph this piecewise function, but I won't actually graph a picture here. Instead, what I'm going to do, since this function is so messy, I'm going to create a rough picture. Okay? What that means is that this is not the actual picture. I'm going to have a big disclaimer on this. This is not the actual picture. It's going to be a rough picture. But here's what we can come up with. We understand loosely what's going to be happening here in this graph. First off, I understand that this function has three parts. These parts can break apart at negative 2. Let's just put that right here. At positive 3, let's just put that right there. And I'm going to color code each one of these parts. So let's have this top part be the blue part, middle part is red, and the bottom part is green. Now again, I'm not going to sketch this exactly the way it is. That is, I'm not going to sketch out exactly these functions, but we should understand loosely what's happening. Notice here that the blue function, will it have a point or a hole at negative 2? Well, it should have a hole, because it's just when it's less than 2. So let's just say that my blue piece goes like this. Okay, that's a good idea. Something like that. Now my red piece, this is going to also have a hole at negative 2. Maybe it's right there. And it's going to have a point at 3. Let's just say it's right here. And these things connect. Okay, great. My last part is going to have a hole at 3. Let's say it's here. And maybe it goes like this. Okay, so again, rough picture, not the actual picture. But by having this picture either on the page or in your mind is going to help us answer complicated questions about this piecewise function. So let's think about what we have here. Let's suppose I want to do the limit of my function as I approach 0. Well, if I want to approach 0, what I can start to think about in my picture is, where is 0? Well, very clearly, we know the x-coordinate of 0 is here. And so if I wanted to move close to 0, what piece of the function would I have to be on? Well, if I want to move towards 0, don't I have to be on the red piece? Like, isn't that the piece I would need to get close to 0? So what this means is that since I want to work with that red piece, I could actually just go ahead and replace f of x with the piece that I need to work with. So again, in this case, since I'm going towards 0, I'm on the red piece. Ooh, how can I determine this limit? Notice, it's a polynomial. So I can actually just directly substitute. So I'm going to end up with the result, negative 5. Great. What if I was working, though, with something like part B, where I have x is approaching 3? Take a look at the picture. If I wanted to approach 3 from both directions, right, this isn't a one-sided limit, it's two-sided, what piece or pieces of the function do I have to use? Well, there's actually two pieces this time, right? I have to approach using the red piece to come at it from the left, and I have to use the green piece to approach from the right. So here, I actually have two different limits that I'm going to need to evaluate to check to see if there's a limit overall. Let's start with our red limit. So here, I'm going to check the limit as x approaches 3 from the left. Now I know that that means that I'm on the red piece of the function, so I can use x squared minus 5. It's polynomial, so I can directly substitute. So I'm going to get 3 squared minus 5. That's the same thing as 9 minus 5, or 4. Well, now I'm going to have to check the green piece of the function. So I'm going to go ahead and say I want the limit as x approaches 3 from the right. That's the same thing as the limit as x approaches 3 from the right using my function, square root of x plus 13. Now, I know using limit laws that I can do the limit of the inside first, and that's going to just get me the limit of 3 plus 13, or sorry, the square root of 3 plus 13. That's the square root of 16, which is 4. So notice that the limit on the left and the right are the same. And so this means that the limit of my function as x approaches 3 is 4. I have an answer. Apparently, it must be the case that our picture is a bit off. It must be the case that my red dot kind of fills in this hole, and then these things connect. So when I come at it from one direction and the other direction, I got the same answer. All right, well, let's look at part C, last part here. Here I'm approaching negative 2. What piece or pieces of the function do I have to use here? Well, yeah, I can see I'm going to have to use the blue piece of the function as well as the red piece. Let's set up the blue one. If I want to approach negative 2 from the left, that's going to be the same thing as using the blue function formula. And that blue function formula is 1 over x plus 2. Notice, this is a nice polynomial. But can I just directly substitute? No, because I'm going to get 1 over 0. But I could make this arrow argument. I know the top's going to 1, and let's think about what the bottom's going towards. What happens if on my number line I have negative 2, and I plug in something a little bit to the left of it, maybe like negative 3 or negative 2.5? Notice that in my denominator I'm going to get something close to 0, but negative. And that's going to give me a result overall of negative infinity. So, my limit as I approach negative 2 from the left is negative infinity. Now, technically, I already know then that the limit here at negative 2 does not exist, because even if the other side comes out as negative infinity, or the other direction along the red curve, it's still going to be negative infinity, which is just a fancy form of does not exist. However, I'll still go ahead and compute this just to show how I would do this if I needed to. So here, I would say I'm going to approach negative 2 from the right. And if I approached negative 2 from the right with my function x squared minus 5, that's my red piece, notice here I would just end up with negative 2 squared minus 5. That's going to be 4 minus 5, it's negative 1. And since these values are different, I can conclude that my limit as x approaches negative 2 on my function does not exist. The picture here, I guess, almost looks like what I have here, and that I have two sides that don't go to the same value. So this is how I can do limits of complicated piecewise functions, even if I don't have the correct full picture. I can just kind of get a rough picture to help me think through what's happening.